just a virtual state. And I should tell you, see, the in Raman, you don't have really, except for the vibrational part, you don't have any excited state in Raman. It is only the virtual state depending upon the incident beam energy. Hence, if you see the other one, where you have the molecule is in the ground state, and if h nu naught is the energy which is absorbed by the molecule, and it makes a transition to the excited state, that is what is indicated by the red arrow there. So there you will see that h nu naught minus h nu m is the energy what you are seeing there, which means that the incident photon has lost the energy. That is what the Stokes scattering lines. Now, let us assume that the molecule was initially in the excited state and the incident radiation is h nu naught, and it absorbs from that state and goes to a virtual state and makes a, and gives out a radiation which is h nu naught plus hmu. That is the anti-Stokes line where the frequency has increased. So this is how now you can understand what are the types of energy levels which are involved in Raman effect, and what are the Stokes and anti-Stokes what we are looking at, and from this how we are going to get the information about the molecular vibrations. Okay. Now this is one part, and this part, since I have already told, I will not touch on that. So most of the measurements are performed considering only the Stokes shifted light, is what I told you earlier. And the polarization, EPS, if you see, it is proportional to the intensity of the light and also to the wavelength of the light. You can see that the wavelength is in the denominator, which means that if I have to have a higher polarization, I should decrease the wavelength, which means that I should go to a higher and higher energy. So lambda has to be small, which means that I should use very high frequency sources. And I naught is the intensity of the source. This is exactly what I was telling you when Raman started doing the experiment. The intensity of the light, if it is very high, then only they will be able to see the scattered particles, which are also equally good. Otherwise, it is very difficult to see the Raman effect. Okay. Now let us see. This is the basics of Raman effect I have now talked. Let us look at Raman spectroscopy and the recent advancements, techniques, and applications. So, it is proven to be a very valuable contributor to study the various fields of science, primarily due to the extraordinary versatility and sampling methods. You can just put it in an aqueous solution and do the experiment. Raman measurement gives vibrational spectrum of the analyte, which can be treated as a fingerprint. I told you, this is specific to the particular atoms which are involved and also the bond between them. Hence, it is a fingerprint and hence allows the easy interpretation and identification of the analytes. Over the last years, there has been tremendous technical improvement in Raman spectroscopy. Because, see, as you know, when we think that a particular field is dying, it will not die, because people will come up with new additions to that and make it to be very, very sensitive. So they have overcome the problems like fluorescence, poor sensitivity, and reproducibility. I'm going on talking about this. Recent advances in Raman spectroscopy and its new trend of application ranges from ancient archaeology to the advanced nanotechnology. I will show you some of the examples for this. Raman spectroscopic measurements applications area are biotechnology, mineralogy, environmental monitoring, food and beverages, forensic science, medical and clinical chemistry, diagnostics, pharmaceutical and material science, surface analysis, etc. And advances in instrumental design of the spectrometers coupled with newly developed sampling methodology. See, why we talked of Raman effect in 1930s, now it is 2020. You have a lot of advancement in the signal processing and other things, and even in the signal detection. Hence, it has made Raman spectrometers are made in such a way that trace level detection is possible and satisfactory analysis can be carried out. This is the modern Raman spectrometer what you see. So you have a radiation source, it goes onto the sample, then you have a wave number selector, and then the output will go to the photomultiplier tube or CCD camera, and this is how you can do the dispersive Raman spectroscopy. The FT Raman spectroscopy consists of a laser source which goes onto the sample, then using beam splitters you split the beams. Then you have two mirrors, one is moving mirror and the stationary mirror. The beam coming from the sample and the beam coming from the source, both will be they get mixed here, and then wavelength analyzed, and that goes to the detector. These are the ways. Now these are only a block diagram level I have talked. You have the complete details of the Raman spectrometers, which you can see in any of the Google. So the most basic part is that a molecule which is Raman active, when there is a change in the polarizability during the vibration. This is the question what we usually ask. What is the difference between an IR and Raman? IR, the dipole moment is already present in the molecule and the molecule will interact with the IR radiation. Whereas in Raman, it is the polarizability which induces the dipole moment. Hence, if there is a change in the polarizability, then only it will become Raman active.
Sorry to interrupt you. Can you just represent your screen, sir?
Okay, fine.
Can you see?
Yeah, I can't. Can you just present it? Just present it. Present it. You just have to present it.
Now I can go ahead.
No. I am not able to see, sir. No. You have to present it. You have muted yourself, sir.
No, I am not. I have not muted.
I am able to. Yeah, resume presentation. Yes. Yeah.
Go
for resume presentation.
Yeah. Now.
You have to just go for that. You are no longer a
presenter. No, we have one. You just see now whether it is on your screen.
No, it is not, sir. Can you just go to that presentation? You just go to that Google Meet, Akash. Resume your presentation. You close that.
You have to close that.
Click on that. Stop on. Resume your presentation. Right. Resume. Yes.
Now?
Yes, sir.
Now you are able to see?
Yeah, I am able to.
So I will just go ahead with this. Now I was talking about the symmetry of the molecule is also one of the basic requirements of obtaining the Raman spectra. And symmetric stretching, bending, and anti-stretching, all of them will become more intense in Raman spectra. So, and particularly the functional groups like carbon with halogen, carbon with NO2, carbon with sulfur, sulfur to sulfur bond, carbon-carbon bond, nitrogen-nitrogen bond are highly Raman active. You'll be able to observe them very clearly, nicely. The shift in the wavelength depends upon the chemical structure of the molecules responsible for scattering. So Raman spectroscopy uses scatter light to gain the knowledge about molecular vibration, which can provide information regarding the structure, symmetry, electronic environment, and bonding of the molecule, whether it is pi bond, sigma bond, or coordinate bond, or covalent bond. Thus permits the quantitative and qualitative analysis of the individual compounds. The development of effective FT Raman spectrometers using NIR and red excitation lasers solved the problem of finding the fluorescence. Actually, fluorescence was a very big nuisance in Raman signal analysis. But now you can see that NIR and red excitation lasers, I will tell you what are the lasers, and they have really improved the sensitivity. And in conjunction with the optical fibers, I will also touch upon this, and microscopes enhance the capacity of the analysis. I will talk of all these optical fibers and microscopes. The type of the lasers which are possible for Raman are argon laser, argon ion laser at 488 nanometers and 514 nanometers, krypton ion, which is
Students, just be online. He will start resume his presentation. Just be online.